To begin at the beginning in the history of the game of polo is not easy. Where to start? True, the Persians wrote about polo some 1500 years ago, and Omar Khayyam scribbled a few verses on the game about hitting your ball to the moon, but I chose to open in England, Aldershot to be exact, the year 1889, where the 10th Hussars were under canvas partaking in summer drills. So here is Paul Withers looking the spitten image of cornered hardtop known to his friends as Chicken, with the captain of the English polo team, Julian Hipwood, with John Horsfall and Reddy Watts, all acting the officers of the 10th on their charges with walking sticks and a cricket ball, and they proceeded to play the first game in England. This burst of enthusiasm had been generated by a report in Field magazine on hockey on horseback as played by the Manipuris. A good lunch and a good whack at the port. It was not a great success, but the potential was realized, and Billy Chain was sent to Ireland with orders to buy small handy ponies of equable temperament. They did not have to go fast, for, as one of them wrote later, no one then realized that one could go the pace of the game. Ponies were obtained, and in this case from John Horsfall, who only went as far as Ascot and Cobham for them. And the first match was played on Hounslow Heath between the 9th Lancers and the 10th Hussars. 8 aside with, as one account puts it, all of London watching. In case some might think that there was skimping in the extras, those of the 1880s that thought they were London were a very small select group, the Beau Monde. The ugly lot did not count. Both sides wore mob caps. The Lancers were in blue and red, the 10th in blue and yellow. A sergeant major dropped a little sphere of white bone, taken from a nearby hostelry's billiard table, onto the center of the ground. The bugler sounded the charge. And the beautiful people tore themselves away from the gossip and chit-chat. And the two sides charged. A newspaper report the next day said that it was more remarkable for the language than for anything else. Good to know that in some respects standards don't change. There were no rules, sticks were clumsy, and the ponies untrained. Using specially made sticks to specifications of the period, and with the tiny ponies, this game was relived with extraordinary accuracy. The start was a problem. Mass charging caused accidents. So, flags waved and individuals charged. If the first missed, then the next charged, and the next, and the next. Periods lasted until a goal was scored, and then ends were changed. An account of the game in the field, July 1870, is as follows. It will be readily understood that a game of this character affords good scope for horsemanship, and is full of incidents of an exciting description, and we believe it is the universal verdict of those who have engaged in it that polo is the best game out. Another method to start. Some enthusiast throws it into the melee of players, but this was short-lived. Too many bowlers got hurt. The original rules and the alterations year by year gave clues as to how the game was played. Rules that stated that there was to be no butting with the head, and no retaliation by holding the offending head in chancery, i.e. grabbing the antagonist by the neck and pulling him off the pony. Note the word antagonist, not mine, but the wording of the HPA of 1874 when describing the opposition. No pushing, punching, no dismounted player to hit the ball. A player was allowed to interpose his pony between his antagonist and the ball. Standing on the ball was all part of the game and referred to as a hung ball. There were many scrimmages until the ball went away and was dribbled across the field, gaining ground. Like soccer with the formation, although the blocking was more like American football of today. The chief exponents of the dribbling game were the Spanish brothers called Murrieta, who took the game to Spain in the early 70s. Here, one brother is played by Alan Kent. The game developed surprisingly quickly. Hurlingham became the center of the polo world, and one of its chief personalities was the Irishman John Watson, here taking a refreshing drink of brandy and soda, a panacea for Victorian thirst, although I noticed that the rules soon brought in restrictions against the use of alcohol and, would you believe, bang, or marijuana. John Watson was a great friend of Chicken Hot Top and played polo in Phoenix Park in the 70s. He served in India and returned to England with many ideas that were to change the static game into the beginning of the modern game. He organized players into a team and developed the backhand. Defense into attack was usually achieved by tapping the ball round. Watson showed that the backhander saved time and could become a dangerous attacking shot. He would cut the ball away from his pony at right angles, time and time again. Although oddly, he hated the use of the near side backhand, thought it unfair. A favorite tactic of his when attacking was to wait for his opponent and then tap the ball under the pony's belly, changing the line, and follow it. By the time the others got onto the line, he would alter it again by a tap under the neck and through the goal. Wimbledon Common in the 1880s. Every morning at dawn, a familiar sight was three brothers. Arthur Peat, one of the most brilliant players of the game. Alfred Peat, known as the boy. And James Peat, known as Johnny, who always played bareheaded. As the Sussex team with Frank Mildmay, they won the Hurlingham Champion Cup 8 times in 11 years. The other years were won by John Watson's freebooters. The Peat brothers trained and made their own ponies. And where others would use their grooms, the Peat brothers worked their ponies themselves. They became the most successful side ever known, and there has never been better.
Let me have a bet. Come on!
Strange how brothers have dominated polo. From the Murrieta brothers, Nichols, Millers, Waterburys, Rooks, Domecks, Horswells, and the two leading players in Britain today, Julian and Howard Hipwood, who with Stuart Mackenzie enact the Peat brothers. The Peat brothers achieved their long hits by using the pony's forward momentum to give the shot power. John Watson, strangely, was not known for his strong hitting. He had innovative positional play with all its inherent dangers of rigidity. The offside rule produced defensive play. Goals became very few. And the polo fraternity was split between those that wished to keep the offside rule, of which the backs of the polo world were the chief advocates, led by Watson, and those that wished to see it abolished, which most forwards did. There was a height restriction on ponies, but the players often disregarded it. Those that made the rules were men who played, and most winked at anomalies that suited them. Sides went from 6 to 5, and then eventually to 4. Hustling with the elbow was allowed as one rode another player out. Crooking sticks was permitted at any time, and could be above the shoulder, although then as now, no one could hook or crook across a pony. Left-handed players were accepted up to the First World War, but they had to be registered at Hurlingham prior to 1907. So English polo flourished until 1909. This was the year of the Big Four. Larry and Monty Waterbury, a man destined to become the greatest player of all times, Devereux Milburn, and the captain, Harry Payne Whitney, played by John Horsfall. They were the American team. America had never beaten England, but this year it was going to be different. Whitney was a superb tactician, and he had the money to back his tactics. First, he bought the best ponies he could find in South America and in England, and so successful was he that the English team found themselves facing their own best ponies playing on the other side. For Whitney realized the value of pony power. To him, it was 70% of the game. He examined the opposition's ponies and matched them in chukkers. The American game had developed away from the English game. The US had handicaps, and this meant that goals had to be scored, which resulted in long and accurate hits to goal. To miss a goal in England was bad luck. To an American, it was bad polo. They met the ball, sacrilege to the English, who turned and took the backhander. And they swung their ponies round back into the game instead of checking and turning as did the English. This was the genesis of American polo, and they dominated the game until the 1936 Olympics, when the Argentinians took over and have never relinquished their grip on the game. Archives throughout the world contain much film on polo, and here is a sample of a match between Mexico and the US in the 30s. There is archive material showing the great players of America, Mexico, and Spain, South America, and in England of the 20s and 30s. Edward, the Prince of Wales, playing with his brothers, the Dukes of York and Gloucester. Hollywood film personalities played, like Spencer Tracy and Daryl Zanuck, watched by other film personalities, Carol Lombard and Katharine Hepburn. Just before the Second World War, England made an all-out attempt to win the Westchester Cup. They sent out to America the polo team well ahead of time to get the ponies and the players acclimatized. During one of the practice matches, Captain Pat Rourke, seen here on the left, was killed. This is a film of his last game. The series went on, with Pat Rourke's place taken by his brother Aidan. But the Westchester Cup remained in America. The other side of the coin shows that polo can be comic, and its imitators say fun is the only criteria, and the 20s and 30s reveled in it.
You have a great way, an up-to-date way of telling me you love me. It gives me such a thrill, I know it always will. My head is turning, and just from learning your estimation of me. And as for you, I'll say, I feel the self-same way. You're the cream in my coffee, you're the salt in my food. You will always lost without you. You're the starch in my collar. You're the lace in my shoes. You will always be my necessity. I'd be lost without you. Most girls tell love tales, and you'll find each phrase dovetails. You've heard each known way. This way is my own way. You're the sail of my love boat. You're the captain and crew. You will always be my necessity. I'd be lost without you.
Today's game has inherited a great deal from the past, and much material is still to be included in the final film. Besides the abundance of movie material lying in archives, and I suspect private collections, we will be using ancient Persian prints from the British Museum and Windsor Castle, illustrating Polo of 2,500 years ago. To finish this presentation, and to show how I plan to finish the eventual film, watch a friendly match between Oliver Ellis, Julian Hipwood, Paul Withers, and John Horswell in yellow, Alan Kent, Stuart McKenzie, Howard Hipwood, and Reddy Watts, portraying, for me, Polo in all its majesty and excitement, demonstrating the influences that all those previous and great exponents of the game still exert.
Backhander by Reddy Watts, written down by John Horswell. Here comes Jim McKenzie, preparing for a backhand. Does a backhand, Reddy Watts, or Reddy is turned onto the line of the ball. Coming down on the line of the ball, preparing to take a shot in his beautifully hooked by Julian Hipwood. Now it's taken off by his brother Howard for the double G's, a beautiful cut out the ground. Now Paul Withers meets the ball, gallops down towards the goal. And the beautiful backhand by Reddy Watts, which is taken down by Julian. Julian hits it towards the goal. It's going to be a goal. It's coming on. Here's Reddy Watts preparing for a backhand. He takes the backhand, again blocked by Julian, straight towards the goal. And again it's blocked by Reddy Watts, who takes the stroke. It's going straight out over the 16, picked up by Howard. It hits his brother's pony up into the air. It's taken straight out of the air by Paul Withers. Paul Withers takes it on and now does a beautiful backhand.
And again.
Ball taken on.
Go on, that goes, Ollie.
On the attack. John Horst.
And again.
He's having the ball.
Your head out, Reddy.
Coming in now. About to try and hook it.
Stand aside.
Leg!
Okay, Johnny, open.
Next one, Stuart.
Got him. Got him, John.
Oh, you son of a bitch.
Thank you.
horizon is the boundary of your polo ground. The earth is the ball on the curve of your polo stick. Until the dust of non-existence rises from annihilation, gallop and urge on your steed because the ground is yours.